morning. I'm a teacher, so you have to wish me. So, good morning. Thank you for introducing me, but I'm going to reintroduce myself today. I am a bee. I've always been a bee in my head. Not the big bee, but this bee. And where did this bee come from? Well, this is the grade that I received in art when I was in school. So this grade became me. I always thought I couldn't do art well because, you know, the bee, it stood for everything that I could do. I'm sure my teacher never realized what this grade did to me. And I'm sure she never wanted it to limit me also or inhibit me in any way. But this is something that happened. It's only many years later that I realized I am not that bee, but I'm much more than that. I'm sure a lot of you sitting here today would have experienced this, right? You are always the grade that you receive. I can do a particular subject only if I know it well or if I've got that A plus or an A star in it. But otherwise, I am that grade. The moment you ask somebody who's got a math grade, you would have got a C or a D in math sometime in life. And if I ask you to do calculations even today, you'll say, I don't think I want to do it. That's not me. Yeah. But we have to realize we are much, much more than the grade that we receive. It takes us many years. But do you know something that children, even today, after so many years, still build their self-esteem, confidence based on these grades? We're talking about 21st century learning. Things have changed. But just imagine if your confidence and esteem is still built in the same way that was so many years back. Where have we changed? And how are we going to equip children for the 21st century? So I thought about this a lot, and I, you know, kept on waiting after working in schools for so many years. I kept on waiting for this moment to come through where there would be change and, you know, like a top-down mass policy approach, things happening. I kept waiting. Things did happen. But then, just like we always do, we wait for someone else to do something. I realized I was doing the same thing. So I said, what can I do in my own space, even if small, to make an impact or to bring about a change? So I started observing human behavior. I started observing children. I started talking to them, interacting with them. What was engaging them? What were the challenges they were facing? I thought about myself. How would I like to learn? I thought about how children would be 20 years down the line. What would they need? I started interacting with adults. What was your experience while you were learning? And from that came up a few things that can be done and which I practice within schools to see that change really could happen. And you know, these are simple things that as schools, as teachers, as parents, as students, everyone can just take on and do. So I'm going to share a few of these with you here today. So just imagine if you had a class for daydreaming in your timetable. Have you ever thought about that? Has anyone ever had a class for daydreaming? Never, right? But do you know that Einstein spent hours and hours just daydreaming? And that's where his ideas came from. You know, just imagine, I mean, if you had to think on a problem or anything, it's just when you sit quietly, you're gazing out into nothingness, suddenly an idea pops up. That's when it happens. But we never allow this kind of time. Parents are busy sending children for classes. Keep them busy. That's good for them. Schools have crazy timetables, all schedules mapped, no free time. So where is the daydreaming? Everyone thinks daydreaming is a waste of time. But do you know that the maximum connections with unrelated ideas and answers to solutions come when you're daydreaming? It's like brainstorming for the creative mind. So just try this going forward. Just daydream and you'll get all your answers. But daydreaming is a thing that we want to do, but there's something that's encroaching all the time in our lives. What is that? Technology. Phones. I'm sure if I asked all of you, how many of y'all haven't looked at your phone for 10 minutes right now, not touched it? I'd have just none. Ah, good to see. We're from a different generation. I'd say that. Yeah, but youngsters today are all the time on technology. And who's the person who we go to when we need to understand something in our homes? You know, a youngster, where technology is concerned, you find it difficult with a new computer or a new piece of a new mobile phone, and you'll have the preteen or the teen in your house who you go to learn technology from. So just imagine if we were to flip the teacher for technology. So the adult is not the teacher, but the youngster is the teacher. They are the digital natives, not us. They teach us better. And on top of that, we all know that when we teach something to someone, we learn it better. So that's how it works. So just imagine flipping the teacher for technology. Something very interesting happened related to technology. I was sitting in a food court in a shopping mall, and there were these two youngsters, a boy and a girl, sitting across a table from each other. And they were texting each other. Yeah, right? They were just sitting across the table from each other, but they were texting each other. So what they did was, the girl would type something, look up at the boy, and the boy would smile, look down at his phone, text something back, look at her, do this. But they didn't speak to each other. And for me, that was something that represented what is happening today. Even when we all go out today, what do? We're all the time on the mobile phone. You go so often, go to restaurants, you go anywhere. You'll see friends sitting together, but everyone's on their mobile phone. You see families go out together. Everyone's on their mobile phone. What's happening? In today's time, face-to-face communication is at a minimal, which is why as schools, because schools actually are spaces where the mobile phone has really not come in as yet. Yeah, you're supposed to transfer the mobile phone outside and not take it into the classroom. So you can't use your mobile phone. So schools are the best places to bring about change with this. So normally when we have free periods in school, you normally have, you know, some teacher being sent across, or you're made to do other work. Something that I believe needs to be done, and something that I work with children on, is I allow them to chill and chat. So important. Face-to-face communication is so important, and I think rather than us taking it for granted, it needs to be retaught as a skill today, so that children know how to communicate with each other when we sit across the table from each other and we stop looking at mobile phones or getting into social media. And I think in today's times when it is so lonely, children are facing so many concerns, this is a very important space that schools can get into, give them their space, and these create these social interacting platforms. But of course, technology is one place, but we can never negate going outdoors, which is a must today. So imagine, yeah, I want you to just imagine these two scenarios that I'm giving to you. Imagine sitting on the hard chairs that you're currently sitting on for hours and hours on end, or if I were to teach you and I was to take you outside, the weather's good, just visualize this, the breeze, you're lying down on your tummy and you're listening and you're learning at that point. Which would you prefer? Outdoors? Most of us would. Yes, and that's so important. We know that, you know, children get distracted very easily. Adults too, nowadays. Yeah? So to create spaces which are comfortable, where children are in a state of relaxed, or I'd say a relaxed alert, allows you to learn better. So why not have classrooms outdoors instead of indoors? Of course, add to that, you have vitamin D from the sunshine and sunlight coming in, all those things. And you know, children at school going outdoors is really nothing new. This happened during the time Shanti Niketan. Everyone is aware of Shanti Niketan. Well, this happened at that time. It was a norm out there. So why not just bring it back into our schools? From schools going outdoors to coming back indoors, you'll see a massive change for the children. When children come back, and research has proved this, that when children go outdoors, have their classrooms outdoors, and then come back into their classrooms indoors, they are more engaged. They can spend enough time to be indoors, but still not get distracted. So a combination of both works very well for everyone. We need to take that. So if you know of educators, you know of schools doing different things, tell them this needs to get done. and of course assessment, coming back to assessment, we need to relook at assessment and examinations in a big way. We spoke about self-esteem, confidence, but there are so many more skills that come through. So while you're in the workspace, we're always told to collaborate. We're always asked to collaborate. So yeah, it's more about we than I. We need to work together. It's always the team that delivers more effectively, or is it the individual? Would such an event be possible with just one person doing it? It wouldn't be, right? It is always about together. But have you all realized that in life, we've always been conditioned about our individual performances? That's the conditioning we've had. We've been brought up from a young age to think only about our grade. What have we got in our examinations? And then how do you compete with each other? And because of that happening, what has happened? There is unhealthy competition. So now if we are to recondition ourselves, we need to start early, which means from an early age, assessments need to be collaborative. Examinations need to be collaborative, not about an individual at all. It's only then will you be conditioned. If I'm taught something from a young age, I continue to do that. How much ever I might change, I will still realign and come back to what I've been conditioned to. So this conditioning has to change. So collaboration happens in schools, even now at a micro level. You know, when children work on projects, you come together, you do it for a short period of time, but that's for a short period of time. Your final grade, what matters, what's going to get you into the college or the course that you want is your own grade. But in the workplace, will that matter? Not at all. So we need to relook at examinations and assessments where there is collaboration and not in the way where it's only about the singular grade. Yeah? So these are a few things that can be taken back, few things that can be done at home. And home, schools, by parents, by educators, and if students ask for this, because students do have a voice today, I think things will change. So keep lighting the fires in the dark. These small changes have a great impact, and we need to revolutionize the education space, and that will happen only if we reflect, rethink, and reboot the education system. Thank you. Thank you.